Welcome, Roger Dooley, to the Netherlands. Very excited to speak to you, to talk to you. I'm a big fan. I've read your book many times, but I failed to implement all of it because it's so much. Welcome, Roger.
Well, Alex, thanks for having me on the show, and I'm excited to be here. And I don't think anybody has implemented everything in the book. That would be some kind of a world record, I think.
Yeah, I felt guilty about it. I'm like, I was reading the book for the interview. I'm like, oh man, how could I forget all this stuff? How do you remember all the stuff that you write about?
No, I guess I sort of remember it, but occasionally I've had an interview or a show like this, and somebody has given me some very little clue, idea number 72, and they give me just a few little facts, and I have no idea what they're talking about, and I have to ask, can you be a little bit more specific?
Got it out. I just got a Windows thing, and I was afraid it was going to restart, but it wasn't. No, but anyway, it's a lot of information, but it's the most amazing thing about it. This is that 95% of the time we're just zombies.
Well, yeah, that number comes from Harvard professor Gerald Zaltman. And he estimates that 95% of our decision-making processes are non-conscious. Now, nobody truly can assign a value to that. I mean, you have to define exactly what you're talking about and so on. But just about everybody in the space agrees that the vast majority of the processes that lead us to make decisions are not conscious.
Yeah.
And often as marketers, we try and persuade our customers or potential customers with logic, with rational arguments, and we're really not dealing with that other 95% of their decision-making if that's all we're focused on.
Yeah, and it's so strange because this has been out for a long time, but I notice it also with myself. If I want to sell a product, I'm like, okay, what are the features? What are the benefits? It's the least important. You have to be, you have to interact emotional. You have to do all kinds of other stuff. So why is this such a difficult concept to grasp for people?
Well, I think as marketers, we tend to focus on the product itself because typically we're proud of it. We helped create it. Maybe it's a new product, and of course, its new features are really exciting. And it's just a natural thing. Plus, we want people to behave in a rational, logical way. We want to be able to explain to them why our product is better than another product, and then have them say, "Oh, okay, hey, great, I'll buy it." Sometimes that works, and I have to say that the features and benefits offered by a product are still important. You've got to have those. If the product isn't helpful to the customer, if it's not going to do the job, then you're wasting your time and marketing it. But those are sort of table stakes that you've sort of got to go above and beyond that. And there's a famous saying, I'm thinking it was maybe David Ogilvy, but I'm not sure about that. It was that, we decide emotionally and justify rationally.
Yeah.
So even if we make a decision sort of non-consciously, whether it's based on emotion or cognitive biases or some of these many other non-conscious influences, we still need those sort of facts to justify that decision later on to ourselves and to our friends and family.
Well, to your friends and family, because when you get home, you have a major purpose. Why did you buy it? You have to sound really intelligent. Why you made the purchase? Right.
Yeah. I mean, why did I buy that red sports car? Oh, because it has great resale value and the gas mileage is really good. Because I'm having a midlife crisis or I think it's going to make me more attractive than if I was driving a sedan. It's a lot of those reasons we can't even articulate. Like sometimes we may know, but not want to say that what they are. Other times, we just don't understand what our own motivation is. And that's pretty common for humans.
Yeah.
But we still need those sort of facts and figures occasionally. But as marketers, we can't make that the sum and total of our arguments or maybe even the major focus. We have to have them there. And just as sort of an example of how many companies are doing this, an apparel company, for instance, say a shoe retailer, they'll have a big, beautiful image of an attractive shoe and just a few lines of copy about it. Now, if you want more details, if you really need to know the dimensions and what the materials are and where they were sourced and all that sort of thing, there may be a tab that you can click on to find that out, because some people you know, for some people that's important. You know, I may buy a shoe and just, hey, it looks pretty good. It's fine for me. But somebody else might be buying that shoe because they are a marathon runner and they're going to use it to train in. And so their criteria can be very different. They're going to want to know some of the facts and figures. And, you know, for that kind of buyer, that information is there, but it's not in everybody's face, because there's actually some research that shows if you give people too much information, yep, they are less likely to buy. It actually slows down that purchasing process, and it takes it out of an emotional decision into a system two, rational decision, logical decision. And they may say, I should probably shop around more. Or, you know, this information raises some questions. You know, maybe it isn't the best for this. So it's best to have that information available, but not necessarily push it right in the customer's face, because it could end up reducing the probability that they'll purchase.
And remind us again, you have the system one and you have the system two from Daniel Kahneman. Which the thinking from the book Thinking Fast and Slow, right?
Yes, exactly. And system one is how we tend to make many of our decisions. It's fast, intuitive, it's emotional, it's rule based. So, like when you go to the supermarket, you may buy, say, 40 items. If you made each one of those as a logical system two type purchase, you would never get out of the supermarket, be in there reading the labels, comparing prices, doing calculations. Instead, probably for 95 or 99% of those purchases, it's going to be system one. Oh, I like this brand. Oh, this worked for me last time. Hey, this one's on sale. I'll buy that. Those are all done mostly non-consciously. And then maybe once in a while, if you're starting a low-carb diet or something and you're looking for bread, you may spend a minute or two reading all the nutrition information. You know, sometimes those are the exceptions, not the rule.
So let's talk about your latest book. It's came out last year, I believe.
Yes.
2019. Friction, or as we might say, we need a lack of friction, right?
Yes, most of the time. I mean, friction does have its uses where marketers can add it for certain reasons. But in general, friction, and let me explain my definition of friction. The simplest definition I use is any unnecessary effort to perform a task. And those of our listeners who are in the conversion space, say e-commerce space, for example, they know already that when you make it easier to buy, more people will buy. If you have a complicated checkout process, you will have fewer customers. You know, if you have a lot of security and fraud prevention things, you will get fewer orders because they will slow customers down and some will drop out. But it has impacts beyond that too. There's some really interesting research from the Gartner Group, the big market research company, that showed what they did. Let me explain the research. They evaluated customer service interactions with companies. So when a customer had to contact the company for some kind of a customer service interaction, support, a problem, a return, a question, something. And they found that customers who had a high effort interaction, 94% of those said they would likely be disloyal to the brand. And that's about 10 times as high as those customers who had a low effort experience.
That's amazing.
Yeah, only 4% of the high effort customers said they were going to buy again, and compared to about 90% of the low effort customers. And word of mouth was even worse. 88% of the high effort customers said they would say bad things about the brand, compared to just 1% of the low effort customers. So, I mean, here, these high effort interactions, things like having to talk to two different people, having to change venues, like you start on Twitter and they say, oh, I'll call our 800 number. You know, or you start in a web chat and they refer you, you'll have to call during business hours. You know, all of these sorts of high effort interactions are not only damage sales, they damage loyalty. And, you know, as marketers, we tend to focus on acquiring customers because, you know, it's a very measurable type of metric. Wow, hey, we, you know, got this many new customers, this many sales for new customers, and so on. But loyal customers are your high revenue customers because you don't have that acquisition cost. And if you are making them happy, they may well even refer other people to you. So those loyal customers are by far your biggest asset. And putting them through any kind of extra effort is just a huge, huge mistake, and it damages loyalty. And, you know, even on the acquisition front, the if you look at disruptive companies that have grown tremendously and grown their market share tremendously, often it is a friction reduction play. You know, we didn't think about taxis as being a very high friction thing. You know, I mean, they weren't necessarily always great, but, you know, if you had to get someplace that were better than taking a bus and better than walking. So we just accepted the taxis were how they were. And then Uber and Lyft came along and suddenly we realized, wow, there was a lot of effort in that taxi process. You know, you're waiting, you called up the company and the taxi's not there yet. You don't know where they are. Are you going to get to the airport in time or did they forget about you? You know, is the person taking the long way to give you a higher fare? And then you have to get out and you want to pay with a credit card. The person's got to reach under the seat to get the credit card machine out and all these things. Suddenly, none of this had to take place. And we saw how much friction there was in the process. And that's why Uber grew so quickly and why customers love their brand in most cases, because it's so much easier than taxi. Same thing for Amazon. Amazon has made it so easy to buy with one-click ordering that you know, people tend not to shop elsewhere. And Amazon, even in the face of increased competition, like everybody else has been upping their e-commerce game. I mean, Amazon got there early when a lot of big brands were still sort of figuring out what to do. But all those big brands now are getting pretty good at e-commerce. Walmart's pretty strong at e-commerce, for example. But even in the face of all that competition, Amazon has still been increasing their market share. And a big part of that is it is simply so easy to A, find what you're looking for, and B, make it appear on your doorstep within 4 to 8 hours that people don't see a need to shop around.
Are they using the drones already?
No, not yet. Not in any commercial scale, but they would love that because, you know, one area, you know, I praise Amazon a lot in my friction book. And when I give speeches and such, I talk a lot about Amazon and say positive things. But one area where the pandemic has exposed a few little chinks in their armor is in their employee experience. We've seen employees complaining that they don't have the right protective gear, that they're being forced to work in conditions that are not completely free of danger and such. There's been some talk about unions. There have been a few little walkouts. None of this has really interfered with Amazon's business too much, but that is an area that really I think is important for them and every company to focus on too, because there's an expression originally attributed to John DeJulius, but more recently, I had Tom Peters, the management guru, on my podcast, and he repeated it probably for the millionth time for him, and that is that your customers can never be happier than your employees. And to me, that's such a simple statement that is so true that, you know, if the people that your customers are interacting with are not really engaged with the company, if they don't really care, if they're trying to figure out, okay, am I done working here so I can go home and do something fun, then your customers are not going to have as great experience as they could. And I think that Amazon's answer for that has been to automate more and more. You know, their warehouses are highly automated when they have drones. You know, I can picture robotic truck unloading, putting the stuff on shelves where it's picked by robots and ends up getting dropped in somebody's doorstep by a drone. And they don't have to worry about all those messy humans in the middle, it's okay. But, you know, we're not at the point yet where any company, like Amazon, has a million humans working for it. So they're nowhere near being an all robotic company.
Now, but you also talk in the book about needless paperwork for your employees, you know, that demotivates them.
Oh, yeah. Well, that's part of that. So that's showing that you trust. You know, I think trust, Alex, is something that is overlooked oftentimes. And it works both ways. It works with customer trust and it works with employee trust. And often we have really bad procedures for our employees because we don't trust them either to do the job right. So we have all kinds of checks and balances and procedures and rules to make sure they do it the way we want them to, or because we don't trust them. Even things like expense reporting, just about every company has an expense reporting process. So if an employee goes on a trip for the company, then they turn in their expenses.
Yeah.
And, you know, they can make that really easy, or they can have really difficult paperwork requirements because they don't trust the people to do it honestly, like make them get a piece of paper for every single little tiny 1 euro, 2 euro cup of coffee or whatever. And that's telling the employee two things. First of all, the company is not placing a high value on my time because I've got to mess around with all these little pieces of paper and add them up and take pictures of my mobile phone or scan them on a scanner. And it also says, well, they don't trust me. You know, if they trusted me, I could just put down how much I spent on meals that day. And assuming it was below some threshold that, you know, could be set, then they would just trust me. And, you know, that would be so simple. It would save time and also exhibit trust. You know, Amazon trusts its customers and they exhibit that in multiple ways. When you, if you have a return for Amazon, like you bought something and it wasn't right, it arrived damaged, you know, it didn't work for whatever you wanted it for, you get a return, you take it to one of their lockers or to a retailer or to a UPS location and send it back. Usually your account is credited as soon as you drop it off or within 24 hours. Now they haven't actually seen what you returned them. You could have sent an empty box back to them. You could have had some other item in that box, but they exhibit that they trust you. And there's plenty of psychology research to show the trust is reciprocated. If I show that I trust you, Alex, you are more likely to trust me. And so Amazon, by showing that it trusts its customers, is in turn earning their trust. And they've got a tremendous loyalty. You know, customers love the brand.
Yeah, so we have a lot of, so they also reduce the friction when you return items. But like you said, friction is everywhere. So how can you give me the friction, the anti-friction goggles that I see the friction and get rid of it?
Well, yeah, you know, when I do a, maybe, you know, a 45-minute keynote or something on friction, I tell people that I've given them so many examples of friction in that time that now they have friction goggles, that they are aware. And by that, I mean that I have turned on their brain's reticular activating system. Your brain's RAS is a filter that screens out everything that isn't important. So if you are going to cross the street in Manhattan in Times Square, your RAS filters out everything except oncoming cars, the crosswalk indicator, and the pedestrians right around you. All the signs and all the irrelevant stuff and all the other pedestrians, it just filters out. Okay, if you had to pay attention to all that, you would be frozen on the curb forever.
True.
When I travel to Amsterdam, I have to retrain my RAS to watch for bicycles because they're probably a deadlier threat than cars. When you start seeing friction by looking at examples, by even some of the examples we've given here today about onerous expense reporting procedures or extra steps in the checkout process, things that confuse the customer in checking out and so on. When you start seeing that, you start seeing more and more because your brain, just like your brain screened out all the friction in taxis until Uber came along. And now, you know, you have to wait by the curb, waving your arm for a taxi and say, wow, this is crazy. Why would humans want to do this?
Yeah, true.
You know, you have to fish for your credit card at the end. Now we see that friction. And by training your brain to see it, you will see more and more. And it's something that just kind of grows on you. I find that if I'm at a conference, when we used to have in-person conferences, that if I stuck around at the conference, maybe for lunch, I'd see people in line having some difficulty in yelling friction, friction, because they suddenly started seeing that where before they probably wouldn't have said anything at all.
Yeah, that's true. You have one of those book titles that just leave it on your shelf. Look at it once in a while, and it will activate your
Yes, that's a good RAS point.
Yeah, it's also true. So it's a good title. And also, you talk about, it's a small side note about sensory, applying sensory to your book cover to make it even more frictionless, right?
Right, right. Well, when you're trying to communicate ideas to people, it's you know, tough to use sensory. I've been big on sensory marketing, and Brainfluence came out years and years ago. I talk about sensory marketing using textures and smell and sound and so on to go to create a brand association or to say something about your product. But when you're basically selling ideas, you know, they tend not to be sensory, they're intangible. Yeah. But I did a few things. I worked with the publisher of the book, and we had some different ideas. I had a little bit more aggressive idea, but the cover, the dust jacket on the hardcover book has kind of a slightly bumpy coating. So that adds a little bit of friction. And what I find is when I'm, say, doing a book signing someplace or in a bookstore where people can feel the book, probably a 1 in 5 will pick it up and say, they'll feel it. Oh, I get it. Friction. So it works in that respect. And I have some business cards too that have a gritty strip on them to highlight the title of the book, but also provide that sensory texture feedback when you hand somebody your business card. And I did something that I found interesting. I got the idea from a person that I know in Moscow who had a business card that was embossed on the bottom, but not on the top. So the top looked perfectly smooth. His card was very thick. And so he hands his card and you feel something on the bottom. And it's like, your fingers are not telling you something other than your brain is seeing. So you've got to turn it over. And on the back, he had a brain on there because he was in the neuromarketing space. And so I said, that is such a good idea that almost nobody does. Usually embossed cards, they're embossed all the way through. So they're bumpy on the top and they go in on the bottom. But I thought that difference, that sort of disconnect was great. So on mine, the little gritty strip is on the bottom where you can't see it if you look at the top of the card.
Yeah, so when I hand it to somebody,
they feel it. Right, yeah. And then they have to turn it over and look at it. And then they immediately make the connection that, oh, yeah, this is friction.
So do you have any of this of what gives the biggest bang for your buck? Like we have a lot of entrepreneurs, also a lot of freelancers, solo entrepreneurs, small companies. So you have the big companies like Amazon, they have lots of bulk, but for smaller companies, what can they do to be perceived as, you know, like the expert, the only solution, customer loyalty? There's a lot of things.
We talked a little bit about building loyalty, Alex. And, you know, I think what I'll do is go to the, if not the father of behavior design, certainly one of multiple parents, and that is B.J. Fogg at Stanford. And he created years ago his Fogg behavior model. He says you need 3 things to create or change a behavior. That behavior could be anything from placing an order to forming a personal habit. So it's a broad model for behavior change. From an e-commerce standpoint, the behavior change you're trying to get is the customer to click the buy button and to complete the checkout process. Mm-hmm. And he says you need 3 things to create or change your behavior. You have to have motivation. The person has to want to do the behavior or the result of doing the behavior. So maybe I want to eat a bowl of ice cream. I'm motivated to do that. I don't necessarily want to exercise, but I want the result of exercising. So maybe I'm motivated enough to exercise. There's got to be a trigger or a prompt, and that can be anything. It could be an email, a visible call to action on a page, a big buy now button, an in-person sales call. Anything could be a trigger or a prompt. And then finally, there has to be ability, and that translates into lack of difficulty, lack of effort. If there is more difficulty, ability is lower. And it's more of a thought graph than a quantitative numerical graph, that if motivation and ability are in the right ratio, and depending on how powerful the nudge is, the trigger is, you'll get the behavior or you won't. And one thing that he emphasizes is that, you can work on motivating people to do the behavior. So for instance, an e-commerce company can motivate people more by, say, giving an additional discount, by giving away a free item. If they don't normally give free shipping, they can do that. They can give away free shipping. And those are motivators that I guarantee you will, in almost every case, increase the number of conversions. But unfortunately, there is a cost associated with those motivations. Now, there are non-conscious motivators Things like many of the things that I write about in Brainfluence, if you go to a travel booking site, you will see scarcity cues like there's only two seats left at this price, or social proof, 48 people booked this hotel in the last 48 hours, you know, and so on. And those are motivators too, and those are cheap. But what Fogg says is that it's almost always better to focus on the ability metric. In other words, make it easier to do. Don't focus on motivation, focus on making it easier. And the Nobel Prize winner, Richard Thaler, it really puts it very simply. He says, if you want people to do something, then make it easier. And this is, you know, is a pretty simple idea, but he pretty much won his Nobel Prize for it. He found that when you made it easier to sign up for retirement plans by making it the default option instead of an opt-in, having people opt out, all in a very transparent and ethical way. It's not a, you know, some kind of a gotcha thing. But that very simple little change had a big impact on society. You know, in the US, people have to save for retirement, and many other countries, if not most other countries, and most people don't do a very good job of it. They tend to spend money now and think about that long distant retirement issue later, until, you know, suddenly they're starting to show some gray hairs, like some of us, and they say, well, maybe I better start thinking about retirement now, when it's, of course, it's kind of late. And that one simple change potentially increased the savings rate and ultimately created a much better retirement for millions of people. But even with that very simple logic, make it easier, there are so many businesses that do not internalize that. And that's one thing that really led me to write Friction, that, you know, people think, oh, everybody knows about that. You know, it's like, oh, that's old news. Well, it would be old news if there wasn't still so much friction everywhere. You know, it's, and you get all kinds of excuses, Alex. You get, why do you have this complicated, identity process on your website? Well, that's for compliance reasons. That's to prevent fraud. You know, it's there's good reasons. Well, we could change that, but there's a lot of code. That legacy code is so old that we're afraid if we touch it, it'll break. You know, there are a million excuses for not doing it, not making it easier. And the smart companies are the ones that are making it easier. You know, and one thing we've seen is the growth of in the financial industry, challenger banks, these fintech firms, are gaining share against the old line banks. And part of the reason is they are bringing, first of all, an understanding of customer behavior and friction to the process, but also they are designing their processes from scratch. So they don't have to worry about, a million lines of rusty COBOL code that nobody wants to mess with for fear of shutting the whole company down. And they are creating very easy, very simple and very fast processes to bring new customers on board, to get them fully operational. And they are signing up new accounts in many cases far, far more quickly than established banks are, even though banking is an area where you would think the brand, the trust, the decades or centuries of history would be super important, because you don't want to give your money to somebody never heard of before. Well, in fact, these very simple processes help create the trust that these new brands need to get new customers.
Yeah, and that's amazing to me. I used to sell mortgages with a prestige bank in the Netherlands. So I also thought it's about the bank, the building, the knowledge. But like you said, it's all about the ease. So people right now, they can just fill out a form, and that'll build a trust, right?
Yeah, it
makes it easier.
In the U.S., the biggest consumer lender is not one of the big brands that everybody's heard of, the Citibank, the Wells Fargo. Everybody's heard of Wells Fargo for the wrong reasons lately, a huge scandal there in the U.S. with them opening up fake accounts. But, it's not the big brands. It is Rocket Mortgage, which is part of Quicken Loans. And the reason that they...
That sounds really shady.
Well, yeah, it doesn't sound like a brand you trust, right? Rocket Mortgage. It's like Spaceship Bank, that. But their motto is push button, get mortgage. Okay. Now, if you were working in the mortgage space, you know what it used to be like, and perhaps still is at some institutions, where you've got a lot of complicated forms. Yep. You've got papers to fill out, papers to sign. It's confusing for the customer. They've got to figure this out. They've got to read instructions. They've got to look up financial information. Well, what Rocket does is, first of all, they import as much data as they can from other sources. So the customer doesn't have to A, hunt it down, and B, transpose those numbers. Then they autofill forms as much as they possibly can. And they try and make it as easy and simple and transparent as possible for the customer.
Yeah, so and you're talking about small things, right? Like autofill, use autofill. Don't lock the user out after 10 seconds of non-use. Right.
Right. All those exactly. Kind of things. Just very simple little things that make it much easier for the customers, and it's worked for them because they. Here's the kicker, Alex. Not only are they the biggest, they have the highest customer satisfaction ratings of all the banking brands and mortgages. It's probably not a coincidence that the best is also the biggest. People like them better than the other brands. They have higher satisfaction. So, if somebody says, well, hey, where'd you get your mortgage? Oh, I used Rocket. They were great. It's really easy. And easy is not a word that one associates with mortgages. I know I've done a few over the years myself. Easy is not really a concept that goes with that.
Opposite of easy. So the mortgage lender is, in the way, is the obstacle between the customer and the house they want, right?
Yeah, exactly.
So remove yourself as an obstacle. So that makes sense. Yeah. So, but another question, also talking about the loyalty and also getting people to see you as an expert and only choice. So like you said, the people already have to be motivated, or it's best if they're already motivated. But if you want to motivate them and want to nudge them, how do you get them emotional? And I'm talking about intangible products, like if you're offering services, like you're an attorney. A lawyer, right, or some other, it's the intangibles. It's
right.
Difficult.
Well, there's a million ways you can do that. I think that some of the more obvious ones go back to Robert Cialdini, the father of persuasion science and author of the huge, huge bestseller over 30 plus years, Influence. Somebody selling an intangible product can use things like authority. Authority means that somebody whose judgment or opinion is respected is endorsing you or endorsing your product. That's why LeBron James might endorse a line of sneakers, because that immediately gives those shoes far more credibility than some other shoe that does not have, the greatest basketball player's endorsement. And that applies in many fields. There's always somebody who's perceived as an expert, and sometimes even that celebrity translates into authority, even though they may not be an expert. So if LeBron James endorsed an insurance product, he's probably not an insurance expert, but just the fact that he's putting his name on it would end up being somewhat of an authority on that, because people probably can't think of a true authority in insurance. I don't know if I can think of one, a true expert that's a household name.
So how do we
things like social proof too. If you can show that other people are using your service and have had good results, and this can come in the form of numbers. If you've got a lot of customers, you can use that number. I've got 20,000 subscribers to my newsletter or something like that. Or you can use testimonials. You can have customers providing their opinions, and those are always more powerful if they are real people, preferably with a picture, a photo, to show they're real. Maybe even with a company affiliation. And one thing that's interesting I've seen done, like in the software space, the SaaS space, is turn social proof into an authority, at least partly authority type of appeal too. So that if one of your endorsers works at Google, say, you might prominently note that this person is, head of this design group at Google. Because not only are you getting that person's endorsement as an individual, you are getting that sort of corporate endorsement. You've got to be careful with that, because sometimes people don't want that affiliation played up. But I've seen in some cases where the name of the brand, which is always a prominent, respected brand, is much bigger than the name of the individual, him or herself. because that's really what they're trying to show, that we have users at Accenture, we've got users at Microsoft, and so on.
Yeah, and you're just using the shortcuts in the brain.
Yes, yes. And you know, when people see that, they're saying, okay, well, this makes sense, because you know, if you lack all of that, if you have nothing to add, that none of those credibility boosters, then you will probably fail. There's a study that goes way back, but some of the principles I think are still valid. And this, I think, was actually maybe Fogg's group at Stanford. It was a Stanford Web Credibility Guidelines. So this was web credibility back in probably like the turn of the millennium or something, when the web really wasn't much of a thing. But some of those things still apply. You know, when people visit your site, use your app, do they see real people? Or do they see cheesy stock photos that look like stock photos of, a multicultural group or something, all smiling? Can they find an address? You know, can they see where you are? Or are you, maybe out in space somewhere, operating out of a garage? Who knows? And there are a bunch of these little cues. Now, those have evolved over time because people have gotten more sophisticated in terms of their, shopping behavior, their web behavior, understanding of how to evaluate sites, and so on. But I think that a quick review of those is still in order, just to be sure that you sort of check off those boxes, because for some people, I will often take a look to see if I can find, if I've never heard of a company, I'll look for the About Us page. I want to see who the humans are behind it. I want to see where they're located, what city they're in, if they have a street address, and so on. It's not like what's there is that critical, like, oh, they're in city X versus city Y. But when none of that information is there, visible, then I start to wonder, okay, is this place for real or not?
Yeah. And also another point is about withholding information, for the infamous opt-in, the opt-in form. After you give me your email address, then I'll give you all of a big, great deal of my knowledge. But you also have some new data on that, and that surprised me.
Well, it depends. There's different ways you can do it. Now, most conversion experts have opt-ins. So, I think that it probably works pretty well, where if you offer something of value, a white paper that sounds really interesting, or a tip sheet with 50 tips on some important topic, and say, hey, give me your email address and I'll send it to you. Many people will opt in, but there has been some research showing that if you give people some valuable information first and then ask them for their email address, that can work better in certain circumstances. So my advice there would be to try testing it. I would not assume that that's going to work in every case. One of the things about behavioral science and psychology experimentation is in the last probably, 3-5 years, there's been a lot of discussion about a replication crisis, that some of these famous studies, other labs went back to try and reproduce the results and they couldn't. And so immediately there was the question, were these experimenters committing some kind of fraud? Were they cheating on the data? Now, there may have been a few cases where people were actually doing something shady with the data. They were eliminating data that didn't fit their model, or a few other little kind of sketchy techniques. But in most cases, I think that the explanation is simpler, and it isn't so much a replication crisis as the original claims, often not even made by the experimenters, but made in the popular press later, were overly broad. Like, okay, so we did this experiment with 50 MIT undergrad students, and now we have discovered a basic truth about human behavior around the globe in all cultures. And chances are that is never going to replicate quite so easily. Yeah. If you try it with a totally different population of people, of senior citizens in Amsterdam, you may end up with a very, very different result. So I think the important thing when we're trying to apply this scientific data is to sort of understand what its limitations are and the importance of testing in your environment. Because, if you talk to conversion experts, they can look at an app or website, immediately say, okay, I think this is probably wrong. And if we change this, it's going to increase conversion. The buy button is misplaced. It's a bad color. It doesn't look clickable, or whatever the case might be. But every now and then, even they are wrong, because the rules don't always apply in every single case, every single time. And that's why it's important to test in your own environment. And, you know, see, just be sure that the what seems to work for everybody else, the general rule, the overall science and so on, is what you need. But what the science does do, it still doesn't mean you have to throw that information out because, well, it's not going to replicate in my commercial site. The science provides your starting point. Okay. It tells you, most of the time it's probably going to work this way. So that would probably be a good thing to try if you're not doing it this way now, but you just can't assume that, oh, well, I'm doing it wrong and change it. And then figure that you've fixed it. You really need to test all the time. And that's one thing that has made Amazon great, Alex. You know, we think, you know, if we say, when did Amazon last redesign their website? And you sort of scratch your head and say, I don't know, when, 10 years ago, more? Because it never, we never perceive Amazon as having redesigned their website. It always looks about the same.
Yeah.
But that's because they are constantly testing at any given moment. They may be running a couple of hundred different experiments, A-B tests, multivariate tests on different aspects of the site. And they're optimizing constantly. When they find something that works, they will then make that small change. And, you know, you cannot argue with success. And so often what I see in e-commerce companies and really all kinds of companies, they stick with one website design for 3 years, 4 years, and they say, wow, this is starting to look kind of old. You know, it's looking dated, got to redesign it. So they get a design firm in. They hopefully do at least a little bit of user testing on a new design, maybe if you're lucky. And then they roll it out. They debug it, you know, if they find there's errors and whatnot. And then they breathe a big sigh of relief and say, great, oh, we're done for a few years. And that's absolutely the wrong approach. You need to be more like Amazon and say, okay, we just need to keep constantly evaluating what we're doing and testing. And not using somebody's opinion to say, okay, yeah, well, let's change this feature. You know, do it with a test. You know, it shouldn't be the most powerful person in the room making the decision, the hippo, as they call them, the highest paid person. It shouldn't be the hippo making these calls. It should be the data.
And if you look at the data, you called out an astronomical number in the US about the abandoned carts, how much money was left in the carts. I think it was about $4 billion, something like that.
Uh-oh. Roger, are you here? Hi.
Just a second, I'm getting a...
Yeah, you're back again. Do you hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you. You want to restart that last question because it's like as soon as you started talking, it went away.
I forgot what was the question. Yeah, Roger, you talked about to put things into perspective, an astronomical amount of money that's left in the carts. I think it was about $4 billion, something
yes,
like that.
Yes, yeah, $4 trillion.
$4 trillion.
Yeah, that's an estimate. Nobody knows for sure exactly how much. And that was a few years ago, but it's a huge, huge number. And the more important thing, Alex, is when another group went back to ask customers why they left stuff in shopping carts. They did a pretty big survey of customers who abandoned stuff. Mm-hmm. Most of the reasons were frictional in nature. The checkout process was too complicated. That they had to set up an account with the company before they could complete the order. That they were confused by some part of the process and so on. If you could eliminate all of that friction, pretty much the way Amazon has done, then you would have way fewer abandoned carts. In fact, when people use one-click ordering in Amazon, there is no abandoned cart problem because there's no shopping cart. The order goes straight from the person's brain to their finger, right to the fulfillment system. And that's what everybody should strive for.
Yeah, but I have to pay them $1 million first.
Well, not anymore. you can use one-click ordering and so can everybody else. Their patent expired. But, you know, that's an important point, Alex. You know, if you talk to coders, web developers, app developers, and you say, you know, you could take some clicks out of this process, they will push back and say, no, it's only a few clicks. You know, who cares? People are used to that. we have to do that. It's compliance, it's legal, you know, all the usual excuses of why they don't want to change it, probably because it's too much work for them. And the fact is that back in 1998, Jeff Bezos and Amazon patented one-click ordering. And, you know, people didn't think they could do that. It was too simple, too obvious. Barnes & Noble, who was their main competitor then in books, they implemented something similar. The two companies got locked in a big legal battle, and millions of dollars. And a couple of years later, Amazon finally prevailed. Their patent was declared valid. And what did they impose on Barnes & Noble and all their e-commerce competitors for that expense of millions of dollars? One tiny little click, just one little click. And at the same time, there was one other smart person. Steve Jobs at Apple was about to launch the new music store. He wanted one-click ordering, and he didn't try and work around the patent. He didn't try and fight it in court. Instead, he just paid Amazon $1 million so that Apple could have that one tiny little click benefit. So when somebody says, it's really not worth it to eliminate those few extra clicks, you know, I just say, well, okay, you must be smarter than both Steve Jobs and Jeff Bezos.
So, Roger, do you have any examples where it's better to use more friction? Like if people can't buy something, you know, like scarcity principle?
Sure. You know, and there's a few places. In sometimes luxury goods are that way. If you have to work hard to make a purchase, you value that more. And so if you are a luxury goods seller, maybe you don't want one-click ordering, you know, for your on Lamborghini.com or something. Oh, that's a pretty cool idea. Just drop in your shopping cart, it'll be on your doorstep in 48 hours. You know, if you make people go through a process to show that they qualify to own your product, for example, you know, that may be way too frictional if you're selling soap, but if you're selling a luxury product, then that will maybe make it seem a little bit more luxurious, even a little bit more exclusive. So that's one example. Another example is in lead generation. You know, a lot of companies focus first on getting a lead and then later qualifying that lead and trying to make the sale. If you are getting too many leads and spending too much time and effort in qualifying those leads and not really getting that many sales, sometimes adding friction to the lead gen process can help. First of all, you can ask for more information. You can add some fields to that form, and that will not only give you more information that'll help qualify the lead, it may eliminate a few of the not too serious leads. So that's an example. And one really interesting example comes from a friend of mine right here in Austin. Brian Massey of Conversion Science is, they had a customer, a client of theirs who was using lead gen. I forget what their product was, but they were generating leads on their website. And they had both an 800 number and a web form. And after a period of time, they found that they could convert the phone leads at a much higher rate than the web leads. The web leads just weren't working out that well for them. So they went to Brian and said, okay, Brian, we want more phone leads. The web leads aren't really that great. So they ran a test and basically took the web form out so that people only had the option of using the phone. And what they found surprised them. Sure, it eliminated the web leads, but they did not expect what happened. It was that they got fewer phone leads. Even though logically, you would have expected at least all the phone people to convert as before, plus maybe a few of the web people would say, oh, there's only a phone number and do that. It actually reduced the number of leads for the amount of traffic. So then they tried another approach. They used a big ugly form. And that was, they offered people the option of the easy, convenient 800 number, the toll-free number, or a really long, complicated web form that they could fill out. And they prefaced it with, you know, we'd like to help you. For fastest service, use the toll-free phone. But if you prefer, please complete this form and we will get back to you at our earliest convenience. So what they found then was that nobody filled out the big ugly web form because that was just too high friction. But the number of phone leads went up over both of the previous conditions. So it actually increased the total number of phone leads. And that was probably because of the friction contrast. You had this form that looked really complicated compared to this really easy this toll-free number, and people use the toll-free number. So that's another example of where adding a little bit of friction, at least in one of the options, ended up working out well. So I mean, there are examples that you can find that exist.
I think I'll try this with my children. You have a very hard option and the easy option.
Oh yeah, well yeah, that's the old. You want to do this the hard way or the easy way?
Exactly, illusion of choice.
The hard way is always very painful.
Yeah, I'm going to use it more. Question for you. Of course, we can buy your books at Amazon because they're pushing your books at the number one, I imagine, after all this endorsement from you.
Yes, probably at bol.com, bol.nl too, right?
You're a fan of the Netherlands. I love it.
Yes.
So you come here often, right?
Or once not that often, but I get there occasionally for speeches and session conferences. So yeah. It's a very, very nice country to visit. And yeah, I learned about Bol when I wanted to get somebody a copy of Friction really quickly. Amazon, oddly enough, was not a quick solution in that market. And so I said, okay, who's the best bookseller in the Netherlands? Yeah. And I found Bol.
Great. So we can buy your books at indeed bol.com, but also amazon.nl has arrived. So yeah. What other sources do you have for all the people who want to do much more with this information?
Okay, well, I really enjoy connecting with people, and I'm easiest to find at rogerdooley.com. That's my starting off point. I also blog at neuroscience marketing.com and Forbes, and I'm on most of the social media channels, probably most often on Twitter, where I am at Roger Dooley, and I am on LinkedIn, where I am, strangely enough, Roger Dooley. So pretty easy to find, and I do enjoy connecting with people and interacting with them and hearing what is on their mind.
Yeah, so I highly encourage all people to just buy the books, because it's so much information. You can't just read it off the internet and implement it. You need a guidebook. I have the Brainfluence one right here, 100 ways to influence the mind to persuade and convince consumers. So, but it's so much information, you won't grasp it. You have to have this near you. So I enjoyed this conversation very much. I love how you knew about the Netherlands. You knew about Texel.
So yes, that's how we connected. Yes, lovely island. Yeah. I was there a little bit out of season, unfortunately. It'd be fun to go there in the summer. I was there in the fall. It was already a little bit chilly. It was nice, though.
Yeah. Well, thank you very much for this opportunity, Roger.
Well, thank you, Alex. It's been fun.